Hope you can see my screen, right?
Yes.
Okay, so thank you. So thanks to join everyone here. So first we just discussed what we are going to do, study in this platform. That's very important. And based on your queries, we can discuss that. After that, we can go with actual session. It's not a demo session, it's actual session. We are going to cover it. That is the plan. First, before starting the session, we must clear your doubts. So based on that, I just opened the syllabus, and you know very well the syllabus same I just shared everyone. So you'll be checking out. If you have any queries, you can unmute and ask me. Okay, always you'll be, you have access to unmute and talk with us. Okay, fine, we can go with that. So this is an entirely full stack data engineer. It's relevant to only data engineer syllabus, and it's based on interview related. All the content, whatever we have mentioned, that is relevant to interview only. We will not be following for any certification practice as well as any other, only for the learning perspective. Who are all mostly coming for the job related, they only get more benefit in this point. Because whenever we are going to discuss the particular topic, we will give you some interview tips. What kind of questions they will ask, something like we will discuss in the middle while we are taking the training itself. Almost most what are the recent trending technologies available, we will be incorporated here. It's based on your interest, you can select that. We will not be forcing you to select everything. It's based on your options, you can go forward. So this is the common where our policy. So 30% is the common theory part is available. After that, 70% is completely hands-on trainings. Okay, 30% I am maximum, I'm just giving the approximate. Because in all the places we are going to discuss via Python and PySpark, how we are going to interact with programmatically. That is our motive. Because if suppose you are a data engineer, you must handle the data with some programmatic in the backend. So that we just mostly covered like that. If you have more than 10 years experience, you must know something relevant to architecture so that we will be combining all the maximum practices, how the architecture we can develop and how we can provide the connectivity and all. That is also we're just planning to cover. And all we will be going with Hadoop 3 expressions because all the people are they are migrating to the Hadoop as well as the cloud platform. So we will be going with only trending practices. Whenever the changes has happened, we'll be going to upgrade and we'll give you. And each of them who are joining the batch, we'll be creating a separate private batch group and we will be monitoring you. In a batch, we will be giving almost 20 assignments we will give you. If you are capable to handle it properly, that's enough to get the job, I'm sure. Minimum 70% we can cover based on the assignments. How much you are doing the assignments properly, based on them we can identify whether you are suitable for the job or not something. We are forcing you to complete that as well. Yes, Robin, we are completely following with Python, not a Scala. Because data engineers who are coming to the in this platform, they must go for data science as well. So Scala is mainly relevant to only Spark development. Apart from, you cannot use it in any other places mostly. So that we didn't go with Scala here. Okay, any other question?
Dinesh, is it good to have Scala, but still it is not required actually?
If we are going to work only with data engineering platform, as well as only Spark, then you need a Scala because Spark source code is based on Scala. If you come across from that and you have multiple environments available, there again, you must learn one of another programming. And one more advantage, sorry, or disadvantage, if supposed to select for the Scala, you must learn about Java as well. That is the backend because Scala source code followed with Java only. So you must learn Java. So another one program, you must learn it. It's a difficult. And the integration platform, everything is a very complexity. You know very well about the Java, but such kind of things we can avoid in Python and we can go forward. And mostly you are joining as a data engineer. In a future, you may be looking for data science mostly, right? So data science platform is mostly relevant to Python. So we just think about the future endeavor and we just included it. And we will be starting the Python from the scratch. Because in a batch, we have freshers as well as experience, both is available and non-tech as well. We have to satisfy everyone. So we will be covered Python from the scratch and then we can go with developments with the Spark and all. That is our motive. Okay. and it's completely slow track. If you have any doubt, you have any question, you can call me, ask your question, you can answer, and then you can go follow. Clear? So course duration is approximately 8 hours. I'm just giving you. It depends. If you are going to select only for the Hadoop development, it will go for 60 hours. If you're going to select for everything, it will go almost 90 hours maximum. Because cloud integration, AWS, Azure, and Snowflake, everything 10 hours planned we have. And we will not be start from the basic beginning, like IAM creations and how we'll be providing the role access, policy access, or VPC creations, something not like that. What you're going to do as a data engineer, that perspective, we just create this, all the, we just mentioning all the services, how we are going to interact with programmatically. That is only we are going to cover it. Okay. Even AWS, if you are going to select Azure or Snowflake, anything. In AWS, we will be covering EMR, EC2, S3, and integration with the DynamoDB and Kinesis. These are all relevant to data engineering. So such kind of services only we just selected. And we'll be making some combinations between the services and make some proper output. We will discuss the syllabus little on later. So course materials, private VM cluster for the local practice for the Hadoop development, we can give you with latest version. Whenever the changes have happened, we just update and give you. Nowadays, we are using as a VM, private VM, but in future, we plan to convert everything into the Docker. So in future, we will give you how you are going to expose via Docker container and practice with it. Because in a real time, you're not be going to use all the services at the same place. Hive, PySpark, and Kafka, everything will not be combined together. Some places we need it. So based on that, why we need to use Hadoop VM, instead of that, we just plan to go via Docker container. That's testing is going on. And we can do with scalability also there. That is a plan, and we are doing some testing there. Once it is fixed, we will share you that. Till now, we are going to using only with Hadoop VM.
Hello.
Yeah, please.
So we will just install the VM cluster, right?
Yeah, local VM we can install for the practice.
So I don't understand that where we use the Docker.
No, right now the VM you are going to use it for practice. In future, we are going to give you everything as a Docker images. All the services will be combined together and we'll give you as based on the Docker's only. So you can download the Docker image and you can practice with it.
So Docker as a means what? What is the use of Docker here? I don't understand.
Here, if it is a VM, you must install that property properly, and you want to provide some resource like a RAM allocation and core allocation, something you have to do it. It is some places it will be going bottleneck, and some system also is going to be hang up some places.
So Docker as a means using as a YARN cluster or something like a Mesos
inside YARN. Inside we will be going, it's a depends on Hadoop. We are going to create with multi-node cluster as well. If you want, you can use as a standalone, or you want to expose into multi-node, that is also you can do that. Same images you are going to split up and practice it in future. Like Spark also we will be planning it. That is testing is going on.
Achha, one more question from the if you talk about the talking about the AWS Amazon Web Service. So are you providing the some cluster on the EMR service, or we have to create?
No,
we have to
we just create and show you end to end how we are going to interact via EMR services and via programmatic as well. We'll be showing to you from end to end how you are going to create the particular service, how you are going to use it, how you are going to terminate everything. We will not be sharing that with you. You have to create with your free trial and you can practice it.
Yeah, yeah. But
it will give you confidence.
But in the free trial I'm using, it is chargeable.
Yeah, EMR is chargeable.
EMR is chargeable.
Yes. We cannot avoid it, right? That's, we must learn it. So a few services are free, a few services are paid. But as a data engineer perspective, you must learn, right? So that we just giving you. If you know the exposure, you can explain to them in an interview clearly what is you have done, right? That exposure we just planning to give you.
So one more question. In the EMR services, means you will submit the Spark job. So in how many cluster you will use?
we will be creating with minimal basis with one node and three, sorry, one master and three node cluster with auto scalable. Okay. We will be created and we will do some projects there on with.
Okay,
then only EMR we can pop up, right? We can use that EMR and integrate with S3 bucket and the Kinesis integration as well. Yes, will be combined together. Yes. Such kind of projects we'll be showing you. First, individually, we will be showing you how the services work and what are the features available, how we are going to create the high tables or something, Spark integration, everything we will show you. After that, we are going to create another service and making some combinations in a project flow. First, we will be going to discuss everything as a one by one as separate services. Something like at the end, we will be combined together and create a project.
So you will only Spark Hive integration, yes? Is it right?
Yeah. So Spark Hive or Kinesis Spark integrations, right?
Because there is a Snowflake and other. So are you covering the Snowflake integration as well?
Yeah, Snowflake via Snowpipe integration, we will be going to cover it. Via AWS or Azure, we are going to make it automatically, and you're going to pull the data, everything will be covered there. Let me go for the syllabus. Okay, so these are all the services we are going to discuss, each one of them separate, how it is working and what is the features. After that, we'll make some collaboration and we'll give you some project flow. That only will be combined. So this is the Snowflake, how the Snowflake is working, how you'll be creating multiple stages, and you'll be making some project flow with Snowflake.
Sorry to interrupt you. Could you please move on the AWS environment? Introduction.
Everything is a data engine allowance.
Okay, got it.
Okay, this is a data engineering platform, so we just covered everything based on the data engineering model. So I intend it will be covered with the storage and the cloud integration and computations power and the serverless architecture, streaming, and DynamoDB, NoSQL for DynamoDB, and RDS for your SQL databases. This is mostly you're going to use in the backend, right?
Yes.
So that's the reason I just inform you, everything will be going with some data engine related. We will not be going to discuss about the IAM policy and all here. It's not required.
No, it's not required. IAM credential is not required.
Yeah.
Because it is a part of the admin.
Yes. The service is already they will be created and giving you how you are going to interact with it. That is the major. So that is only we are going to study it here. Okay,
you can move.
Okay, so recorded videos as well you have, you can practice it and you can review it. And this 20 assignments, whatever we are going to giving you, that is relevance to whatever we have done the hands on, the same you are going to do that. But based on your interest, we will reward you first 3 members who are completing all the assignments at the end. Those 3 members, we will be giving some paid rewards. That is the plan. Because without your involvement, we cannot go forward. So that is also, we just planning it. All the class notes, practice materials, and architecture, everything we will share you. You can practice your own. And this is the entire course overview, what you are going to cover it, what you are going to study here properly. Okay. So from the Hadoop, we just planning to start Hive. And once Hive is over, additionally, we're just going to start with Python basics. Python is not a basic to intermediate level. Both will be covered. And then we'll be going to start with PySpark. All the PySpark up to batch project will be covered. RDD, data frame integrations will be covered end to end. After that, we are going to see some batch projects. Hive also, we'll be going to see a separate Hive projects. How automatically you will be creating that based on the scripting, everything will be going to cover here via Hive. After that, PySpark also, you'll be going to see some batch project, how we are going to interact via Hive and do some analysis. So in a Hive batch project, that entire the shell scripts and integration platform, unit testing, everything will be covered based on the project flow. After that, Spark streaming is going to be start. Spark streaming and Kafka streaming both will be covered. We will be separately taking PySpark streaming projects. And the streaming projects, if you are going to select for Hadoop, you may be learn only for Kafka integration as well as some Twitter API integration, something how you are going to retrieve the data in real time via Twitter, something you are going to see in real time. If you're going to select for Azure AWS, with respect to the particular streaming services available, how you are going to interact with that and read the data from there. That is also, we'll be going to discuss it. Once the Kafka is over, and then, where it is, okay. After the Kafka, we'll be going to discuss about Docker integrations. How Docker is working, we'll be covered only the Docker. We'll not go with Kubernetes and all, because based on most few of the places, as of my experience, I can see few of the places you want to create the Docker files and you want to deploy the customized images, not all the places. So that as a data engineer, you must know how the Docker is working. So that we just included here, via Docker, you're going to submit Python jobs, Spark jobs, and integration with the Cassandra. This is how you're going to practice it. Once Docker is over, only one application as of now, Cassandra, you are going to practice via Docker containers. Because all other applications we have already pre-built and installed in our VM. But for your own practice, you must know one of the only one service. So that we just giving you Cassandra as a Docker container, how you are going to interact with that, something like that. Once Cassandra you know very well, then Docker also you know. Right, the backend Docker container, you are going to do some hands-on and practice, you must learn the Docker as well. So that's the reason we just giving you only one application based on the Docker container. And Cassandra internal architecture, how it is working and how you are going to interact via other tools, something you're going to practice that. And then Airflow scheduler, all the topics, what all is available that we are going to cover, discuss, like what is the sensors and some so the sensor and some operators is available, everything we are going to discuss. And you're going to submit Hive or some Hive operations and Spark submit operators and the Python operator, bash operator, shell operator, so bash and the base operator, everything you're going to see, and sensor operator also you can see there. And then in the PySpark projects, whatever you have done, the batch project, you're going to schedule via Airflow, how it is repeatedly working. This is also you're going to monitor. So these seven is relevance to Hadoop. Hadoop and Docker were also choosing for your studies, that will be covered. And AWS, separately 10 hours will be covered. This syllabus also we just provided. In Python, these things, yeah, okay. After that Hive session, I said, right, topic two is covered. Hive projects is over, we are going to start with Python. Once Python over, we just planning to go with Spark. So in Python, it's an intermediate level, as I said. So data type collection and the string integration, control flow, functions, classes, NumPy, pandas. So if you are a data science platform, NumPy is required. If you are a data engineering platform, pandas is required. So additionally, two libraries, how it is working. Such kind of combination, we're just going to show you. So Hadoop, these are the major topics, you know very well. Hive also, all the materials majorly is using the real time, that is, we'll be planning to cover it. Separate projects for Spark and Batch, as well as streaming and Kafka and Dockers. Dockers, you're going to discuss about Docker architectures and poke forwarding Docker image integrations with network management and value management and creating your customized your own images via Dockerfile or Docker Compose. This is you're going to be studied here. Cassandra, this is the common sense. Cassandra is a kind of backend database only. So what is the functionalities happening in the backend? That's what we are going to discuss here. So yeah, executors, operators, executors, and sensors, some ad hoc queries, how it is working. Next, AWS, already we have discussed. If you're going to select Hadoop and AWS, then you'll learn up to topic 8. 1-2 topic 8, that is for AWS. If you are going to select Azure, we are going to discuss blob, VM, as well as SD Insight, SQL databases, and SQL data lake integrations. Data lake Gen 1, Gen 2, how it is working, the difference between that two, we will be going to discuss it. IoT Hub directly, we cannot use it, but we will be going to create some event up and we'll show you how streaming we are using via Azure. That is also, we are going to cover it here. recently, nowadays, Azure is trending. So overall, is looking for the Azure platform, that would be better. Because already AWS has reached the margin, Azure is still growing.
Are you covering Databricks in Azure?
No, Databricks is separately, right? And now only they are incorporated, so we will not be covered that. In a previous patch, we just make it up, but due to less nomination, we just removed and we can include this perfect now.
Okay, like there are two deviations after a topic 8 and topic 9, either. Can we choose both Azure and AWS, or
that's your wish?
But as of now, means AWS is a very means good because most of the companies are adapted AWS because it is very cheap.
It's not like that. Depends on the margin because Azure they are giving a few services as a free nowadays for the corporate. So if you know the recent year, Azure is mostly reaching that actual platform. A lot of the companies there are going with Azure. So because they are integrated with the Databricks and that they will be developing a lot of the course analytics in the backend. So it depends on who else the existing project, they will be go with AWS. Who else going to be creating a new project, they may be select for Azure or GCP. GCP also recently trending and competitive. But they will not be reached into the AWS margin. The problem is in AWS, if you are go for the interview for the AWS related, you already have almost 20 candidates or 30 candidates for a single position. But Azure, the competition is very less now. So you will be getting the job very easier to compare with the AWS platform. That is, I mean it. Any other question?
Yeah, sir, can you hear me?
Yeah, please.
So this course will be helpful to only to attend the interviews, right? But not for the certifications.
No. Because the problem is in certification, we have to learn one tool at the end to end, right?
Okay.
So if supposed to start with Spark, is mostly will be support for cloud or certification. To be frank, I'm saying because that particular, because you can see Spark only have two tabs. So end to end, we just mentioned everything because most of the platform they are using via Spark only they are playing. So this may be help you.
Okay.
But we will not be focused via certification because very less candidates only looking for the certifications to compare with all others. Who are coming for the training, their expectation is a job. So that we just convert our content into job related.
Okay.
Because nowadays if we go for the interview, they in job description also you can see they will be looking for multi-skilled. So you must know all other tools, right? How it is working, how you are going to make some integrations. That's very important, right?
Sorry, I'm jumping. So we cover the memory optimization as well as the memory calculation as per the data and like partitions, how many partition will be used and how many memory.
Exactly. In Spark, especially working, right?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah,
yes,
in
exactly.
Spark.
We are going to discuss about resource allocations, how we are going to allocate the resource based on the total availability, how it is available, and what are the configurations options available in the backend. That is we are going to discuss on calculations about executable memory, driver memory, and, number of cores, and dynamic allocation, how we can do that, and recently AQE, adaptive query execution, and Spark 3, how it will be helping you. Such things we will be going to discuss.
Okay. Arun, I have a clarification. See, overall, the curriculum looks like you teaches on admin and the development part also, right? That's how it looked like.
No, it's not a part of admin, to be frank, because already everything is available. Only for cloud you want to create for yourself. That we will show you.
It is totally development part, not admin. Some part from the AWS and the environment, but in real time, they already means create a cluster. We have to spin up only how many nodes is required. So according to this, we have to spin up the cluster.
Yeah, exactly. The problem is in VM, we can use only standalone, but in Docker, if you're going to use it, you can make some spin up also for Spark and Hadoop. So that we are doing some testings there. But the problem is the complexity, how we are going to understand the Docker. That's very important. So how we are making some scripting based on its execute, it will execute in the backend. As well as it depends on your OS operating system. Somebody is using macOS, somebody is using for Windows platform. So it should be compatible for both of them. Something like we just validate. So that we have some challenges in Docker, but still we are doing the testing. If it is succeeded, we will share the Docker images for your self-practice. That's the plan actually. Okay. So mostly relevance to development here. That is I'm informing you before also. For AWS and Azure, you must know the service, how it is working. So here we maybe cover the basics admin, how you are going to create the service, how you are going to terminate the service, and costing, how the costing will be charged. This kind of validation we will be doing here. Here you maybe learn something with relevance to admin.
After completing this course, like what kind of roles we can apply for?
Data engineer relevance, any roles you can apply.
Okay.
So is this useful for freshers or only for experienced candidates? Because after knowing all these skills, if we go directly to the interview, they will ask us, right? You don't even have any experience. So will they hire, like, is there any chance for that?
Yeah, it's even freshers also, they can hire it, right? Because of the fresher, they must know the concept. As a panelist, they will think what kind of concept you know very well. They will scrutinize. As an experience, you must know how the integrations and the performance wise. Okay. So both we will be discussing here, right? So you may be confidently answer them with 80%, we are sure. Because most of the question, how they will be asked as a panelist, we know. And that such kind of questions, while we are doing the hands-on itself, we will give you some inputs. And you maybe go for the interview, you can bring your questions, we will discuss during our session itself. Like that is kind of community integrations. Mostly 80% sort of. But it depends on your interest, how you're putting your force, that's based on only you can get points. That's why we're just tracking some assignments. Properly attend the assignment, complete it on time, then we will sure you can clear the interview. But we will not be making that assignment as a complexity. It's easy. It's an intermediate level we will give you, but the problem is you want to practice. You maybe have some problem. You want.
And how about you will be giving a lab access or something, or it will be installed in our own machines, all the components?
This is the VM. I can show you right now. There's a VM right now, Ubuntu 18.04 and 2.3 version 2.3.1 you are using. Okay, this is we will sharing you. You are going to practice this one. Here, all the tools will be installed. You are going to practice for your hands-on. Whatever we'll be going to cover, right? That is integrations. Everything you are going to practice here.
Dinesh, you will teach us on some Linux commands also?
Yeah, from the basic, while starting with the Hadoop, right? Before starting Hadoop commands, we just go with the Linux basics because both will be correlated, right?
Right.
So that before starting Hadoop commands, we just discuss about the basics Linux, and we'll go with Hadoop. It depends on your batch members. So if anybody is expecting for the Linux commands, we just discuss that also, and we can go with Hadoop commands.
Okay. Thanks.
Any other question? The Hive, shell script, Python is a very important, right? And SQL concept. This three is a major for data engineering. Who are else going for the data engineering platform? They must know this three things. So that we will be going to discuss such points before starting each of the topics. If suppose we are going to start with the Hive, we must know about how SQL is working something. So here you have the VM. You can see all the services should be enabled on there. Okay, like that, all the daemons will be enabled automatically. You can practice, and this is almost 50 GP. You can roughly practice it. If needed, we can increase and give you. Depends on your data validations and data your exercises. If suppose you need this more than 50 GP, we can spin up and we'll give you for your practice.
You mean the data size of more than 50 GP?
Yeah, you can store this your data with up to 50 GP here in a single VM.
Okay, so for to have this on our system. Is it okay if you have a 16 GB laptop?
Yeah, that's enough. Minimum 8 GB is required. 16 GB is more enough. You can ask in 8 GB here. That will perform better.
Okay. So 16 GB, we can really practice. Yeah. Okay. 16 GB, we can practice with a sizable amount of data. Can we do it with a couple of terabytes of data or only 50 GB or 100 GB?
No, we can maximum hold our data with the 50 GB.
Okay.
This one.
Oh, in this VM environment.
Exactly. Okay. This kind of restriction we can avoid by we're supposed to go with Docker images. That we don't have any restrictions with our data size. Because everything we are going to mount via volume, right? That we can incorporate. Only the problem is that memory consumptions. So that is also we have to allocate it.
Okay. So Docker again will be in the cloud or
your local. We will give you all the Docker separately. We will be create and install it. And we will give you the Docker image information and the execution command. So if suppose you want to use for Hadoop, Hive, and Spark combination of some projects, you can enable that only and practice it. If suppose you want to do some projects, Kafka and Spark integration, you can enable that particular service and practice it. Because we will not be using all the services at the same time, right? So whatever is required, you can enable and practice and stop it.
It depends
on your use case. You are going to practice it, right? Based on some assignments or whatever. That is, you may be using it. Right now, Kafka is working local, no problem. But we have some troubles with Hadoop executions, with different OS. So that we will be stuck some places.
So Mac would be a little compatible to Linux and environment, right? Mac would be
but architecture will be modified, right? Some places what they are doing, AMD system, they are going to purchase it, so they are that particular architecture, it will go with AR64 architecture. So such kind of system, we don't have any proper images, we have some bottlenecks there. So it depends on your architecture and the operating system, the Docker image will be modified.
One more question for Python, either Python Sparks. So any tools required, PyCharm, like a PyCharm Anaconda or something?
Yeah, while practicing our environment with hands-on in Python, we'll be going to use PyCharm, Jupyter Notebook, and the third one, VS Code. Okay. Mostly PyCharm and Jupyter Notebook, we are going to practice in real time. It depends on your use case. If it is a streaming, we must go with PyCharm. That would be a better, right? If it is a batch, we can use for Jupyter. Because web console output we can see, right? So both we are going to do that.
Okay.
It's not a single idea.
Dinesh, I have one question.
Yeah, please.
Yes, what I should do if I have 4 GB RAM only laptop?
Then you must increase it. You don't have
it any... will very slow.
Yeah.
Yes.
At least minimum 8 GB is required. Try to increase it.
Oh.
The problem is whenever you're going to practice it, right, it's getting irritating you. You will not be doing the practice very well.
Yes.
So we're requesting you at least 8 GB you can bring up.
Because right now...
That installed Ubuntu OS on my laptop.
Okay.
It's better than installed VMware.
VM you can install, but in Ubuntu, if supposed to install VM, then you want to reserve some memory for the particular VM, right? So there you have some problems. So let's take it out. 4 GB of RAM you have. 1 GB you can allocate for the US, 3 GB you're trying to allocate for your virtual machine. How many cores you can allocate there? While suppose you're going to run any MapReduce program or Spark program, it consumes the memory as well as core. At the time, your entire services goes down or it will be hang up. So you cannot confidently doing your assignments. That's what I'm thinking. It has happened, to be frank, I'm saying. So try to increase at least 8 GB. That is our only one request from you, from our end.
One more thing. Suppose, you know, if I get an opportunity to do an freelance work in big data, do you think the 16 GB of RAM would be enough for that, or that won't be enough in a real time?
No, if you have a freelance and you have a proper team, then you can expand it. Actually, I am also working with some freelancing. I just expand my system with 56 GB of cluster. 3-node cluster I just developed.
But if you are doing the freelancing, so there would be a means like another cluster, VM cluster, so where you can just use the more memory.
Here I can see this is one of machine learning laptop I'm using. Here almost it's 32 GB I'm using here. Total 32 GB. Like that, I have 16 GB, two laptops available. I can combine and creating the cluster here, and I can do some practice.
Oh, we can combine two laptops.
Yeah. Via IP integration, we can create the two slaves and we can integrate here. Something like we can achieve it. But 16 GB, how we are going to do that, I am not sure.
So 16 GB would be a difficult one in that case.
Yeah.
So 32 GB would be a fair enough one in that case.
Yeah. But if supposed to do freelancing, that must be important.
Okay. All right.
Okay. For a self-practice, we'll be going to use some TISE dataset only. How it is working? Within 5 minutes, that how the command is working, how we are going to see the data, something like only we are going
correct,
to
discuss. Correct.
Because if in a training we are going to use huge data, then it will be taking your time. And it's unwantedly eating your time as well, right? So right. We don't want to do that. We are using only sample data set. How the concept, the functionality is working in the backend, such things we are going to practice here.
Got it.
Okay.
Dinesh, what is the duration of the course?
Minimum 3 to 4 months. That's what I said. It's not relevant to duration. It's a slow track, already I told you. So all the syllabus, right? Everything we will be covered. And suppose anything is missed, you can ask us directly. Sir, this is not missed. You can take the session, something like you can inform us and we can cover it. So it's a content basis. All the content relevant
these will
to
be recorded interview. Sessions, pre-recorded yeah. Sessions.
No, it's ordered live sessions only.
Live sessions, right.
Yeah, we'll be going to start with the Hadoop, right? Hadoop topics will be covered. After that, Hive is going to be started. Once Hive is over, Hive projects will be covered. And then Python is going to be started, Python basics on the intermediate level. So this is over, and then we'll go with Spark. Spark, first we just go with RDD and data frame. And we are going to see some PySpark related batch project. After that, we are going to start with Kafka and Spark streaming and structure streaming. What is the difference between that two and how you are going to interact with your Kafka? Something like you are going to practice it. After that, we are going for Spark streaming projects. So the projects should be a pipeline. Okay.
Will you provide the each everyday recorded video?
Yes, exactly. Yeah, I'll show you that also too. How your sessions look like. Okay, those are samples. You can split up Hadoop, Docker separate, AWS, Azure, Snowflake. Okay. So in Hadoop Docker, you can see recordings. All the recordings will be loaded here. Which state it was taken and what is the content it was. And then class notes. What we are going to discuss and what is the reference architecture we are going to discuss there. Okay. Reference architecture will come in the paints. Okay, here are all the reference architecture. We are going to discuss it here and load it. All the paints and all, what are we going to practice it tonight? That information and the assignments, we'll be going to store it. Also, we will give you some common drive. In this common drive, you have a VM as well as sample data set and other recordings, which means it's an old one, which is not usable now. But in some cases, you may practice it, right? Right now we have scope only. So we just give you this recording. This is you can use for your self-practice. If suppose you're going to work with scope, because this is not covered in our batch, but it was earlier, it was very famous. Now it's retired. But even though in such cases you want to practice it, then we can cover this also. as well as sample resumes and libraries. Here all the ebooks are available for your self-practice. You can learn it your own.
So Dinesh, in this case, as part of this course, right? So in Hadoop, we have Oozi or something in prior, right? Now, what is the job scheduling tool which will be using as part of this course?
Like Airflow. Airflow is recently trending all the places. Airflow 2X is recently trending more.
Yeah, Airflow is more better than because it is showing the DAG.
So entirely you can use it. Oozi you can use only for big data platform. Other platform, right. If you are going to practice it, then it will be, it's not suitable. But Airflow is not like that. You can use all the platform. You want to integrate by AWS, that's possible. You want to integrate the Hadoop, PySpark, that's possible. GCP or Hive tables or MySQL, SQL Server, anything you can connect and you can use it. So it's a very famous and trending one of the tools in scheduling part. So that we just covered it.
So in terms of cloud technology, right? So you mentioned like either of AWS or Azure will be provided, right? It's up to us which one we do select, right?
Yeah, that depends on your interest. We will not be forcing you. Even if we are a fresher, you don't want to learn anything with the cloud, that is also fine.
Okay.
That's what we just in the nomination form itself, we're just mentioning you. We get a course what is going to be covered, the syllabus details. You can click the syllabus and you can learn it. And all the based on your selection option, you can use it. Okay, session timings we can give you. If suppose in a future we are planning to add a GCP also here, but you learned already, but you want to learn a GCP again as a separately that one you want to learn as a old student concession, we can add you that particular session, and you want to pay minimal charges, not a maximum. It will be a minimal charges you want to pay and learn it if required. I'm saying. Not forcible. Okay, because technology will be modified. And what is the trending based on that, we'll be going to add it in the future as well. So there you want to learn something as a new, then we will allowing you and you can learn it. Okay?
Okay. So these are only the weekend classes, right?
Right now it's weekend classes.
Okay.
Weekdays is going on, so we don't have time. So we can only right now, we just started the same time, 6 to 8.
Okay.
Okay. And one more thing, payment. Most of them are asking the fees and payments. Here, all the detail we just giving you, maximum 25,000, minimum it will go for big data platform, 15,000. And others, if you are going to specifically select 20,000, you can pay and you can practice it. And this is also, we can give you 3 installment, you can pay. Okay, suppose you're going to select a full stack developer, you can pay 3 installments. While joining, you can pay just 5,000 rupees. And within a 1 month, you are not satisfied, we will give you 100% refund back to you. Okay, your 5,000 rupees entirely will be refund. Even for a single rupees will not be taken. After 1 month, you are satisfied, you can pay 10,000. And then next month, you can pay the rest of the 10,000, something like that. It's based on your confidence also, it's very important. So that we just divided. Within 1 month, if you are really not satisfied, you have some problems, okay, fine, no problem. We will refund your payment without any questions. Okay?
Yes,
and in a batch, we are going to use only maximum 15 members. It's a reserved. Because the quality is very important, so we cannot go forward more than 15 members. So in a single batch, maximum 15 members. Few old students we can allow, so 2 to 3 members they will add it. It depends on the new technology they want to learn, they are only allowed in this batch. So 15 members, it's restricted. And who are all paid, based on the FIFO based, we can allow them, that's it.
Okay. Dinesh, would you mind going back to that screen where you have the packages, right?
This one. Okay. Tell me.
Okay. Here, suppose if anybody have a knowledge on the big data perspective, right? So they worked on basic concept of Hive, Scoop, and data integration from the other legacy databases. In that case, which course do you suggest to proceed with if they have the big data knowledge?
No, it depends on your use case, right? You'll be working in a company. What is trending? What is useful? Which is available in our course or not, something you want to check it out, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we cannot forcing you to select this one or this one. That's your option. This is the options only we can give you. So it's depends on your interest.
No, that's right. But what I'm asking as a suggestion, like, you know, maybe you can discuss one-to-one on WhatsApp or something. But I just wondering if anybody have this question in mind.
Yeah, first we must know what is the architecture, what is their backend role, whether they maybe come from ETL tools or something they will use. Our DevOps also, they are coming. So what they have done, what is the opportunities available, best and only we can suggest to them, right?
Okay.
That is the correct one. So it's the same general solution will not be suitable for everyone. So it depends on your platform and your opportunities, best and only we can suggest it. If you are a fresher, some places only one cloud is enough. There we can suggest to them, you can learn this one, maximum is enough. 4 hours having a campus interview, they will expect some more than that, right? That we will be suggested. But experienced people we cannot restrict like that. It depends on their opportunity only we can go forward, right?
Okay.
Because in our batch, 18 years of experience people also will be available. They have all the opportunities. So exactly. We cannot avoid it. So something like, it depends on your opportunity and use cases. It will be that your options. We cannot restrict or interfere in that.
Okay. And another last question from my friend Dinesh. In terms of the job change, so suppose I have a 8+ year of experience. I have a big data prior experience. So I worked 1 year back in big data. I know the concepts and all. If I just brush up the things, I will be. And along with that, so which all the, like if at all I take a complete full stack course, whatever you're offering, will that be enough for me to change the job?
Like 80% we will be sure. You just go for the interview after our session, you just go for the interview, 80% mm-hmm. whatever they are asking the question, right, which is relevant to our topics, I'm sure. 20% will be modified. So that I'm saying, while discussing our session itself, all the topics will be informed, all the interview questions will be discussed. So each content, what kind of question they may be raised. Such kind of things in discussion only is going on while taking the sessions. And it should be interactive, like what you are talking with us, right? Same like in a session also. Any places you have doubt, you can unmute and ask your questions. We will not be stop and mute everyone, and at the last 5 minutes, 10 minutes, we'll not be open the discussions. So not like that. Any place you can hold us and you can raise your questions.
Okay. So do you give some Java basics also? Like any
no.
any
okay. No. It is confusing while you go for the interview. Because if you know first during starting our sessions, we plan to give Scala and Python both. The problem is while they are going to explain that interview, right? While they are giving any hands-on, they have to write some program, they are confusing a lot of the places. And while we are giving the assignments also, we can see while practicing with Scala and Python, they are combined together. So it's a correct way. It's not a correct way. So that we just plan to go only with Python. Python definitely will help you in future as well. So that's how that.
So if we want to go for Scala as well, then is it feasible?
Not exactly. If you are, let's take it out of your example. Scala, you learned. You're doing very well the practice, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And you want to integrate with cloud integration, Azure and all. So mm-hmm. S3, you want to do some serverless architecture.
Mm-hmm.
Then Scala will help you. Again, you want to learn our Java, right? Java API only, you can connect it and you can do some analysis. So it's a multiple program you want to learn it. It's supposed to select Scala and all. I'm not forcing you, just giving you the thought. If you know very well one program, that will help you in the future as well. Right? That's our thought, and we're just giving the... What else?
You mean to say like Java is not that essential, right?
Not like that. Java is famous. While I'm starting my career, I just start to go with Java. But the problem is multiple developers, they are using Java and complexity also huge. If you go for the interview, programmatically they will lock you. Okay, Java, all the questions you cannot answer properly, right? Even Java certification also they will ask you. But if supposed to select for the Python, you know Python very well, because Python is very easy, right? It's easily you can learn it as much. And you go for the interview, you can clear the interview by programmatically, and you can explain that what are the hands on use cases via DSA, data structure algorithm also, you can explain it. So learn any one program properly and you can go forward. That is for the future as well, you want to think it. So data engineering after the data science one is available, or DevOps maximum, right? There also you can use your Python. So we just plan to go only one program. That will definitely help. It's my experience, so that I just select this one. I'll be working with Java, Scala, and Python. After Python learn, I don't have like to go with Scala and all. I have other opportunity to data science as well, so I just use it. And the future endeavor also, Python is more enough, right? Am I right? So make it, program is an easy one, you will learn it. That's enough, I think so. It's my experience. If you are working and learn program more than other integrations, you cannot learn it. You don't have more time. So you can optimize your timings and efficiently you can use it. It's okay?
Thanks, Dinesh. Thanks for clarifying.
No, it's my suggestions. Others have different opinion. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Any other question? Okay, mostly we have discussed, right, all the topics. Anything that I missed? These are the old developer speeches mentioned. Now it's skipped.
So, Dinesh, one question.
Yeah, please.
Yeah. So, like, will there not be a concept of MongoDB coming into in this data engineering part?
No, anyone NoSQL database is more enough. So, Cassandra, we just included. Cassandra as well as DynamoDB. These two you may be helped with, right?
Mm-hmm. No, I'm just not sure. So just wondering, like, will MongoDB?
No, if it is a scale, if you're going to make some distributed and scalable platform, MongoDB cluster have more space, it will be acquired. So in a front-end development, they are using MongoDB integrations as well. For the back-end, mostly they will not be using it. As of my experience, I'm saying, okay? Front-end developer only, MongoDB integration, they are using it. Because JSON format integration, they will be using for config. But in the back-end, they will, most of them is not selected. They will be, if it is a Hadoop cluster they are using, HBase, they will be selected, but it's a dependent. But most of them, they will be migrated into the cloud environment. So HBase is not useful more. So Cassandra will be used in all the places. And if suppose you go with AWS, then DynamoDB is available.
Okay.
In Azure also, we have a Cosmos DB that we plan to integrate in the future based on timings, how long that session is going on. Based on that, we will be planning to include Cosmos DB. Cosmos DB, inside we have a MongoDB API is available. If needed, we can include it. Otherwise, Cassandra is available there also. So we can learn it separately, Cassandra, right? So we don't want to include that also there, but in future we plan it based on the timelines. Okay. Yes, Abdullah, this session is recorded. Yeah, always, this is a weekend, the same time, 6 to 8 p.m. we are going to discuss it. And suppose you are a fresher, you joined and you feel to ask any small questions, don't hesitate. You can reach us in a private chat. while discussing, right? At the time itself, if you know a small keyword you don't know very well, you can ask us separate private chat window. We will answer without mentioning your name at the time. Because we have faced and we will be getting the feedback. So based on the feedback, we are going to improve it. So don't feel I'm a fresher, whether it is suitable for me or not. We will try to help you as much as. Okay, experience, they will not be feared. They will ask it, but we can see in a freshers, few of them, they will be asked. Okay, so everything is fine. So no question, we can start our session soon. Any other questions? Yeah, trainer, mostly three members will be taking the training. One is myself, I am taking the responsibility for the entire batch, and another two trainer, they will be using for cloud as well as some other tools they will be using. It depends on their timeline, we will be shifted. But I am the responsible. If you have any queries, you can reach me in a private as well, no problem. Okay, if you have bad feedback with our trainer, you can reach me separate, I can change it. I am the entire responsibility for the particular batch. Okay. That's it. So if we don't have any questions, then we can go with some.
One last question, Dinesh. With respect to, you know, like, as these combination of full stack you mentioned over here, right? So like in which all domains this will be, you know, like currently I'm working on a banking domain, right? So in that case, a banking domain like will not be moving to, you know, the Azure or the cloud basis at this moment. Okay, so in that case, like to either for switch or something, I would not be, once I complete this one, right, I would not be able to, you know, utilize this learning experience to the, you know, the in the real world or whatever I'm working now. So in that case, like how that will how to learn, basically, like, you know, like how to utilize this learning.
Yeah, this is what I said, and based on the opportunity, you want to select your option. I said the, all this you want to say, I'm not forcing to select for full stack. You maybe go with any one of the cloud, or it's not required. You can select only for Bitnet and Docker. This is common, right? You must be used at any places. So it depends on your opportunity. You want to select the particular option, you can go for it. That's it. Okay, now you understand, right? Even experience also, they have some problems. They have some opportunity hiccups. So based on that, you want to select. We cannot force to select everything as a full stack. We will give you an option. You can select any one of them.
Okay. Sir, is recorded video is available?
Voice is breaking, ma'am. Can you come again? Hello? Yeah, please tell me.
Yeah, so while we like just we complete this course and do hands-on experience with along with, you know, like with practice of ourselves, with all this exercise, whatever you provide. So will I hope will that be sufficient to look for a change, right?
Yeah, true. Because these are also mostly using, right, training technology tools. If you know this integration, how it is working and all, and some sample real-time projects comparisons, you know that you can sustain, right? So that we just planning it. Mainly, it depends on your assignments, how you are going to do that and how you are going to handle the project sessions. We'll be doing some project session, the same we are going to assigning you, how efficiently you are going to handle it. So based on that, we can confirm how much you are good. If some, we have one-to-one session also after the particular batch. If you have any concern, we can discuss them separate, we can help you. And while you go for the interview, before that, you just inform us. We can convert your architecture with respect to our big data platform, and we'll give you. Mostly 40 minutes to 1 hour maximum the interview is going on, right? The first 15 minutes depends on the architecture, they will be discussed. So if you are going to work with your real-time current scenario architecture, then 15 minutes is going on. after 45 minutes, you must know the tools properly. Such kind of questions will be handled by interview basis. That's what I said, 80%, I'm sure. Whatever we are going to discuss, that should be asked in that interview. 20% rarely will be modified. That kind of question you can bring to us, we will be discussed during our meeting, our session.
Okay, so after this course also, you'll be assisting, right, on the perspective of, like if at all we have any questions we come across from the interview or something.
Yes.
I just to like know like
that's
how
that's what we just creating a private batch for you. Even if okay. If you are going to raise any question, the question will help for other members, right? Everybody's exactly. Looking for a job.
It's so, recorded video.
Yes, it's recorded only.
Okay. Yeah, why that question came to my mind, Dinesh, you remember, like, what I want to say is, I was working on before, like, you know, the full stack Java developer, then, and recent in 2012, the big data was evolving, right? That time I just learned and changed the technology and changed the companies also in the same fashion. So along with this cloud experience in the Docker and the AWS and all, right? So just wanted to know whether it can be, you know, helpful to change the company.
Yeah, until 2014, Java is famous. After that, yeah. It is moved. Okay.
Correct.
So, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Before that, I'm also thinking I learned Java. I just worked with Scala. I have done my certification, one-off certification via Scala only. So, at the time, it was very famous. We don't have any option. We must learn only Java. But after 2014, everything is modified. What is now? What is expected in a corporate? Based on that, we have to modify.
Correct.
If suppose you are asking me this question 10 years back or something, 7 years back, you suppose ask me, I preferably say Java must be learned. But now it's not like that. Okay?
Yeah, I agree.
True. Yes, this is recorded. Yes, Ravindu, this is recorded. I will share you this recording after the session. Don't worry. Okay.
Okay.
Perfect, Dinesh. Thanks for your time.
Okay, so we can discuss some of basics with the Hadoop then. Okay, so we can directly go with Hadoop introduction. Hope this is visible very well, right? So what is Hadoop first? What do you think about Hadoop? Anyone? Difference between Hadoop and Big Data. First, tell me that. What are the competitive tools available apart from Hadoop in Big Data tools? Anyone know that? Sorry, voice is breaking.
EMR, Apache Spark, these are all competing.
It's not a Hadoop, right? It's not a Hadoop framework. Difference between Hadoop and Spark is a different.
Difference between Spark and Hadoop, if you talk about the MapReduce in there, so mostly MapReduce is a very slow in compared to the Spark, because Spark means fire the job in memory, means in the RAM. And computer, if you talk about the map to disk, it is a kind of the disk. There are lots of the difference. If you talk about the streaming, so we can do the streaming in a Spark, but we cannot do the streaming in a, means we can only, it only support the batch data. There is a chunk of data. So yeah, there are lots.
Yeah, correct. But actually Hadoop and Spark comparison is actually wrong. Can we store any storage in Spark? Can we do that?
Yeah, pardon?
No. Dinesh, I have one request. Can we go ahead on the class actually? Just keep talking on this. Can we go ahead and start the class actually? It's been 1 hour now.
Yeah, it's going on. That's what we just started right now. Mm-hmm. Only we just started the sessions.
Okay. Yeah, pardon?
Yes, actually the comparison between the Hadoop and Spark is not a correct one because both are a different layer. Okay. We cannot store any data in Spark. We just only processing it. Spark is a kind of Spark processing engine. That's it. Hadoop have a two layers available. One is storage layer, another one is processing layer. So storage layer we are going to handle via SDFS. Processing layer only we are trying to match with MapReduce concept. This is overcome by Spark. So Spark also analytics engine. Nobody is saying how Spark is, we can use for any story layer, not like that. Only for, it's a replacement for MapReduce. We can process the data from any sources and we can use it. A beginning Spark is created for integration Spark. After that, it's standalone Spark in our list.
But in a Spark, we can just store the in various, like a standalone as well as the local, you know, Muslims. Local system, S3, SDFS.
Truth. Spark, at the beginning, it was introduced only for Hadoop-related ecosystem integrations only. After that, it is working for standard performances. Okay, till now, for by default, storage layer for Spark is Hadoop only. Okay? But we can change it. If suppose you're going to work with EMR, then you can change the Spark engine in the backend. What is the source system? You can mount it properly. Something like default source system, you can modify. But at the beginning, Spark also using only for Hadoop layer, Hadoop integrations. Alternative Hadoop tools. Hadoop is one of the big data tools. Actually, Hadoop is a framework. Alternative multiple framework is available. SyncSort, Chip, and another one, I forget. So a few of them is a competitor tools available, but that's a paid. Hadoop is open source. And you know very well about the Hadoop history, right? It was introduced by?
Dogcutting.
And it's copied from?
Microsoft.
Google.
GFS, Google File System only, it's copied. Right? They have just copied the concept and changed the name. They are calling us a master and chunk, which is converted into in Hadoop as a name node and a data node. This is a basic idea. Okay, in SDFS, we are going to handle multiple daemons based on the way Hadoop is working. Because it's a distributed layer, we are going to process it. Okay, so we are going to discuss the daemons. What are the daemons is available inside the Hadoop? Can anyone tell me what are you know? First is name node.
Name node, data node.
And then?
Secondary name node.
And then? Standby name node.
Data node.
Master.
Name node is a master. Right?
Node manager.
Node manager will come under to Yarn.
Yarn.
So Yarn have a resource manager. And then node manager. Inside the node manager, we have containers as well as application master, right? So we can see via architecture how this is, because few of them have some experience and expertise this, but few of them is not like that. So let me take a three node cluster here. So it's a distributor, so three machines will be combined and will be created, right? Okay, so this is called as a name node. These are all called as a data nodes. Okay, this is a four node cluster. One should be a master, another three has a slave is working. So it's a master slave. Always when I'm Hadoop is supposed to combine, it is called as a master slave. So what is the responsibility of name node is doing? What is the responsibility of name node? What is actually doing? If suppose I want to store 1 GB of data.
Sending the job request to the data nodes, processing where the data is present, passing the
close to correct, but small changes. Name what is actually doing?
Managing data nodes.
Managing metadata. That is right. That is a major work, right, for name node. If suppose I'm going to store this xyz.txt, this file, I'm going to store it by a name node. What this name node is going to do? File directory, where this file has to be stored. This information has to be monitored. Directory as slash user, some places data. This is the directory. Okay, let me take this. This is the directory, the data is going to be stored. And then metadata, what is, what kind of file type? Inside this one, it can just monitor what is the file type, this one. And then what is next? Replication, where the data is actually replicated. 1 GB data, I'm going to store it. This data will not be available in name node. This has to be stored in any one of the data nodes. If it is a 1 GB of TXT file, it will be split and store it with multiple partitions. So the partitions here is called as a blocks. Let me take this two here. Six. We use the space. Total 8 blocks we can create, right? 7 and 8. So total 8 blocks. It just printed because default block size is 128 MB. So 128 is supposed to divide by, sorry, 1 GB of file is supposed to divide by 128. This will be created as 8 partitions. 1024 MB as 1 GB divided by 128 MB will create as 8 partitions. These 8 partitions you are going to store as 8 blocks here. This is, I just mentioned. This is not actual concept, because based on the file size, and how it is going to be stored, that all we are going to see via Hansa. But this is for the references I'm saying. 8 partition is going to be split and stored look like that. This is the first data is going to be stored. Name node how have all this information. Data node 1 have 2 blocks of data. And data node 2 have 3 blocks. Data node 3 have 3 blocks. These are the basic informations. Now it will be following with the replications as well. Now this data will be moved into data node 1, and so data node 1 data will move into data node
2.
It will be copied into data node 2. This data also will be copied to, that is replication means copy only, right? Sorry for my wrong words. Okay, as well as this data will be moved into this place. Some places it will be copied. For the safety precautions, it will be moved some places. This kind of information also have in name node. So data node 2 blocks will be stored. This 2 block information will be split and stored into data node 2 and data node 3. Same like another one, data node 2, that information will be stored into data node 3, data node 1, and data node 1. Example I'm saying. Like that, all the data where it will be replicated. This information also name node have. The reason is,
Dinesh.
Yeah, please.
Data node 1 means in a one block, suppose there are 2 partitions. So suppose there one partition data, like a first partition name is A and another partition name is B. So is it possible to means A data in a node 1, A data and A data?
Okay. I hope you got I my can point. A and B, I can understand the partition divided. I can understand. What is your last question that I just confused?
There are 3 partition in the data node. Okay. And the okay. So suppose my question is partition A. There are 8 partition. Partition A, partition B, partition C, like that.
Okay.
Till 8 partition. Okay. Then I just announce the name. So can we take a yes, not a B, A. Is it possible to replicate here? A.
No. No, same partition data will not be replicated here.
Because if one node say goes down, so we cannot replicate from there. Yes. So that's why.
That's why this A will be replicated here only. This is kind of concept will be monitored by block scanner.
Block scanner.
Scanner in a Hadoop 2x, they are calling us a block scanner. Now in Hadoop 3x, they are calling us a intra node, intra data node integrations. Okay, this is will be valid where the data will be available, whether the same data will be trying to replicate on the same node or not. All this information will be monitored. This information only will be sent to our name node as a block informations.
You meant to say A partition cannot be copied in the same data node. Is it a restriction or is it a wrong practice? I mean,
system will not be, as per the Hadoop algorithm, it will not be copied the same
internal data.
Internal
architecture it is.
Okay.
Hadoop algorithm will not be allowed you.
Yeah.
The problem is if suppose this goes down, what will happen? Entirely this node goes down.
We cannot take a...
That particular record, you cannot take it out.
Take it out.
Right? Okay. So you need an alternative. That's what the replication has come to the picture. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Any other question?
No, from my side.
Others? If any question, you can ask me in chat also, no problem. Okay, fine then. This is the common architecture we have discussed. File type, replication, block information, and how the data will be stored, and whether the data is alive or not. Such kind of information will be stored in the name node itself as a metadata references. Name node have only metadata, which is loaded into the RAM memory. there's always will be running with a RAM perspective. Okay, so here only you have an alternative name node, have another node is called as a secondary name node. Okay, secondary name node is nothing but same, it will be keep on getting all the information from name node and make some ready. It is called, it is like a backup integrations. Something I forgot to tell you, secondary name node also kind of checkpoint node only. Yes and no. If suppose name node is not active, this in any cases name node goes down, secondary name node will taking the responsibility. That's it. So another name as secondary name node is checkpoint node.
So what role does standby node play if that's the case?
Yeah, that is next time coming. Standby node, name node is another one thing is available. Your space more available. So okay, let me use it here. So entirely will be monitored by your zookeeper. That is also one of the concept. So all the functionality will be monitored by your zookeepers. Okay, name node will be keep on monitor and will be confirmed by zookeeper, and then it will be alert by SDFS federation. It's a different concept. Right now we don't want to touch it. We will be come back to our standby name node. This is another one. I can make both of them is the same color. Standby. Space is not available. SPNN. Okay, it's just for a single image. Okay. This is also will be keep on listen and monitor. Okay. But the difference between secondary name node and standby name node, first tell me, can we use standby name node and secondary name node as together? Anyone have an idea?
I think no.
Actually, we can use it. Hadoop 2x, they will be allowed, they can use it. But the restrictions in Hadoop 2x, standby name node should be a only one, you can use it. That standby name node mainly used for high availability. If suppose any failure, standby name node will taking the responsibility immediately and process it until secondary name node taking the in charge. This is the only reason standby name node come to the picture. In Hadoop 2x, we can use only one standby name node. Hadoop 3x, we can use n number of standby name node. Okay, this is another name called backup node. Okay, so we can use standby name node and secondary name node together for a single Hadoop cluster from Hadoop 2x onwards. In Hadoop 1x, do we have secondary name node? 1x which? Any idea? Anyone?
No.
Actual is yes. Secondary name node is available, 1x also, but the problem is manual interaction. We have to start secondary name node, then only we can use it. No high availability. Because if this stay name node and stand secondary name node, both of them say equal computation configuration power is available. It should take up, but it will take some time. This kind of high availability they have to avoid it. That's the reason they will become for standby name node separately. But that is also a restriction. We can use only one standby name node, and the maximum cluster we can use in Hadoop 2x is 10,000 minus 1. Maximum data nodes we can use. Hadoop 3x, they have overcome and they have removed this kind of thresholds. So that is the difference. If suppose there anybody is asking the difference between Hadoop 1x and 2x, this is also one of the reasons you can say. And single point of failure, it's called. Because spoof, this is secondary name node will not be enabled automatically. So single point of failure, there is a chance will happen in Hadoop 1x. We can avoid via backup node in Hadoop 2x. That's the answer. Another one is yarn. We will, while we are going to discuss about yarn, I will tell you. Okay, so backup node, secondary name, standby name node, and high availability we can monitor. Checkpoint node is called as a secondary name node because it's always will be monitored. All the validation will be followed with some concept is called FS images here. It is both name node and the standby name node, both will be working as a RAM integration only. This is all in the backend with system as a disk basis. Once a name node is failure based on some timing only, secondary name node will take the in charge. At the time only, all the data will be moved into the RAM memory. It's a kind of rubber stamp on its doing, its activity. Any question?
To an external system who is trying to upload a file, the arrow that you have shown over here, xyz.txt, is he going to identify the system with a name node, or is it going to be a name?
No, I just locate to the Hadoop and, please go ahead, sorry.
Yeah, no problem. See, the point I wanted to understand is, someone is uploading a file to the Hadoop. So the request comes to name node directly, or is there somebody who is intervening the request and passing it to name node? Because here we are seeing a backup node, name node, and as you mentioned, the moment name node goes down, in order to support the high availability, his backup name node would come into picture and handle the request before SNN, the checkpoint would become active. Am I correct with my understanding, or am I?
Yeah, right only. So suppose during that time, name node goes down, any request comes, which is handled by your standby name node and that may admin. Because name node is not available, at the time, all the responsibility will be taken care by your standby name node.
So who is delegating this redirection of request, which is coming from the external system towards the SPNN instead of when name node is detected to be found down?
Yeah.
Someone else who is sitting between.
During the time, standby name node only will take the responsibility whenever the request comes. If it is a storage based, then it will be handle it and store all the metadata. If it is a processing based, it will be diverted to yarn. Okay, yarn only is taking care of all the resource allocations and processing layer execution.
So as of now, what we are speaking is about 1.x or 2.x or 3.x.
Mostly we'll be going to discuss about 2.x and 3.x.
Okay, so the current picture, does it depict 2.x or 3.x?
This is 2.x. It will be combined for, it's a common for 2 and 3.
Okay,
the difference between 3, you can use multiple standby name node. Based on some regions, you can create, zone-based, you can create it.
So this is without yarn in picture. Am I correct to say?
Yeah, or still we will not be reaching to the yarn. We are
if yarn
about the internal architecture about, yeah.
Right.
So processing layer will not be touched up still.
Yeah. So if yarn is not in picture, who is taking the responsibility of delegating the call to name node or backup node? Who exactly sets who picks
the storage based, if you're asking, then standby name node will take in the responsibility first.
No.
If it's a processing based.
See, it's something like this. If I were to think in terms of Java or microservice or a service, these two are two different processes. Name node is one process and backup name node, I could designate another process. And when we are saying high availability, it should be a cluster of machines which are being represented as one single machine, one single entity to the external world. So the request that is coming, who is handling it? Is there someone who is interfacing the call before it even reaches the name node or backup name node?
No, actually, all the requests while it's reaching to the Hadoop, it's a kind of threading only, right?
So is there someone who is handling that initial threading?
That threading, whenever it comes, if name node is not available, by default will be redirected to standby name node. Because here it only it's always ready, right?
Right.
All so the metadata information is available. It's redirect to standby name node by default.
So, yeah, my question is who is the one who is checking whether the name node is up or backup node is up? Is there any separate process which comes in?
That is a zookeeper.
Zookeeper. Okay.
Yeah, that is, we'll not be discussing that point more.
Okay.
Whether
okay.
it is going down or not, that is, we will be validated by zookeeper only.
Okay.
That's what I just mentioning. This, all the monitoring will be handled by zookeeper.
Fine. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Any other question? Is Hadoop available in cloud or some other mechanism is used? In Hadoop cloud, they are using Hadoop as a separate cluster like EMR in AWS, HD Insight as Azure data proc for GCP. Okay. It's a kind of service only they are using. Actually, in cloud, their storage they are using as a cloud integration with distributed. If suppose you're going to create multiple services in the cloud, that will be directly interact with your storage layers, like S3 bucket in Hadoop, AWS, blob storage for Azure something. They will not be using any particular framework like that. They have created their own. Okay, yeah. I got a question in chat window. Okay, so till now you're clear, right? We will not be discuss how this zookeeper is working. This is called ZKFC. Zookeeper failover control as a concept is available. We will be going to discuss in some time. Based on that only, it can be monitored whether name node goes down or not, something. Okay, we just still discuss about how name node is working. What is the internal algorithm, how it is working. Till now we are discussing that point only. We will not be going down. Name node, data node, secondary name node, standby name. These four only till now we just discussed how the block will be swapped. Just 5 points. Any other question?
Dinesh, the data node will be coming in case of the same architecture in HDFC, right? HDFS.
Yeah. Same only. SDFS architecture only data node and name node is available. How name node is working once the request is reached, how the name node is working, that only we just discussed. In middle between the name node and data node, we have a middle layer, that is a yarn will come to the picture. We will not be started yet. I will tell you in some time. Till now, we are discuss about this first, this things only. Okay. Okay, fine. Till now, everyone is clear at this point. Now, we are going to discuss about yarn. Yarn full meaning is yet another resource negotiator. Okay, here it is coming like this. In middle, it will come. We don't have space, I forget. Okay, separate, I cannot use it, okay. Okay. Just think this is as a yarn. So what are the storage layer, how the name node is going to be get that information stored into data node? That is, will be taken care by name node itself. If it is a processing layer, I want to do some counting or I want to do some process on top of the data. This is stored. Now I want to process on same data. 1 GB of data will be stored on /data. This place, the data will be stored. I want to count the value, how many records is available totally in this platform, something like I want to do that. This kind of validation will be handled by yarn only. Whenever the request comes, name node just blindly move that request into yarn. It won't do anything. Just where the data is available. This kind of metadata information will be collected from here and informed to Rian, okay, this is the request I have received. Please take care, and this data will be stored in this place, in this places, something like. Immediately, Rian, what is going to do? It is going to be raised as a job request. Okay, I want to count the value. This is the MapReduce code or Spark code, anything I'm going to process it. Now, Jan, what is going to do? It is going to be interact with its own internal daemon, which is named as resource manager. Resource manager is nothing but it is going to be create as a job. Some based on some application ID. Okay, the request application ID for this request, this one, something like it will be confirmed and it will be acknowledged with Yarn and assign some resources here. Okay, this request, this data, 1GB data only, you're going to process it. This data already name node is given. This is the place data is available. Okay, you can take care 1GB of resources memory. You can use it for this particular request. Such kind of resource allocation, Yarn will be negotiated. And then resource manager going to be start its process with multiple tasks. So based on one application ID, there may be multiple tasks available because data will be split up. What is going to be happen in the backend, mapper or reducer or Spark concept task, whatever. It is going to be validate based on the data sizes, it's going to be assigned the number of tasks. So task will be generated. This task will be monitored by each one data node of their own node managers. Each data node have own data node managers. Okay. This node manager can get this request. Okay, this is the application ID. Task one will be assigned to node manager one. I can mention something like here. Node manager one, node manager two, and node manager three, something like. Task one with respect to node manager one. Two with respect to node manager two, three with respect to node manager. Okay, two itself I can assign it for understanding. Okay, now node manager two have two tasks, application ID with respect to two tasks will be assigned into same data node. Here, same application ID with respect to one task as assigned. Everything should be complete properly. This one task has to be complete and this two tasks has to be complete. All the tasks completed, then only this application will make some success flag. Otherwise, it will make some failures flag and inform to Yarn. If any places, any one task will not be completed properly, then application also is going to be down. There is the reason some concept is called speculative execution. If the task is going down or it will take more time, some performance down, it will be reallocate the particular task where the places the same data is available. Based on that, multiple tasks will be created and will be start the process. Whichever is going to be complete, based on that, it will be get that information and make this as a success plan. If job is success, then we can assure, we can efficiently read the data and we can send back the output to the client. This much of data, this is the output for this particular file something. Okay, something like it will be happening. Executions. Okay, it's a depends on some data node is available, resources available in the same data node. Speculative execution will be repeatedly created on the same data node. If resources already allocated and it's blocked completely, then where the actual replica data is available, based on that, it's going to be start here also. Okay. So till now we just discussed how resource managers working, node managers working. Any question till now? These 2 points. Okay, fine. Next, we are going to discuss about inside of resource node manager. Node manager, actually each request that comes, it's going to be allocated, right? Total 1 GB of space I want, sorry, RAM, it will be allocated by YAML. Node manager one will be taken care by only one request. So 256 MB of RAM, it will be allocated and trying to process with one core for this particular task. So name node, so node manager two have this, both tasks are node manager two. Let me mention as a 256, what's going on? How much? I forget. Seven sixty-eight MB of data, and for this particular task, we can assign two cores. This information we can provide to the resource manager based on the node manager is going to be created. Now, node manager one have only one request, so 256 MB of some reserved memory will be created. This is called as a containers. Inside, once the reserved memory has created, and then reserved. Inside, the particular core is going to be processed. One core, right? That is called as a application master. Okay, so for understanding purpose, I just mentioned. Same like here, this is two tasks going to be processed. So total 768 MB as well as two core will be assigned here and processed. Okay, so this is, yeah.
What is the task here, and does this container somewhere, you know, is it something similar to Docker container or
No, just reserving the memory here, it's called as a containers. It's not a Docker containers. Inside, each task is going to be processed, right? At the time, it want to load the caches as well as the particular data, it needs to process it inside the RAM. Each node have some, data node have some memory, right? Let's take it out. This data node have 32 GB of RAM and 8 cores available. We have to reserve it for the particular task. While I'm starting this process, each node have this much memory I can mention. So this particular task, I want to assign 256 MB of memory, RAM, I want to assign it, and I want to allocate one core for this particular task. So maximum, at the same time, I can assign and process 8 tasks in parallel here, because 8 core only maximum, right? Just example I'm saying. Based on that, the task will be created here and process it.
So this you can say that Jan is already aware of what all tasks are already running on this data.
How much stored? Yes, exactly. How much resources available? All the information will be mounted by Jan only. Total how much each have done? Okay. I just informed, right? 32. 96 GB of memory is available here. 96 and 24 core is available. Total how much it is. Particular job I assign, this much of memory I assign. So release balance is this much only is available right now. Such kind of validation will be monitored by YAML, and this only will be assigning this particular request, how much we can assign for the each task something. Okay. While we are going to process any MapReduce job, that I can show you how the YAML is working, how the memory is allocated in there.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Clear? There's a total memory information as well as core information available in YAML.
What if this data node one has already got huge number of tasks because of which the cores are already filled? So if there is a new task, will Yarn allocate a task for that data node? Or even if it allocates, is it going to go and sit in the pool so that if one of the tasks gets completed, then the next task would execute, or how exactly it goes?
It depends on the some queues is available while assigning the task. So it's a FIFO or capacity scheduler queues available. Based on that, whether I want to assign the task into the same node or it will be alternative something. If suppose this is fully occupied, capacity scheduler based, if you're supposed to execute, this is fully occupied. The rest of this is free. So what Yarn will be take the decision, it will not be assigning the task here, the new task, where the actual data will be replicated available. There the task will be reassigned and will be keep on working it.
So is the task going to be executed only at one node wherein the data is available, or is it going to be run at both the nodes wherein the data as well as its replica is available?
No, any one of the placement will be running. Worst case, if any delays is happen, there you want to run in the both places, then it's called as a speculative executions.
Okay.
Okay. That particular task is very important. It won't be failed any cause. There you can enable speculative execution and start it. There what it will do, it will be make some timeline, how much estimated timeline should be executed. If it is meet that and still it's running, then immediately Yarn can consider and create a new task in a different place. Whichever complete first, based on that, it will be close this particular job. Okay, something like it will be happen.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any other question?
I'm good, thank you.
Okay, almost we are in time 8 o'clock. So till now you are clear, right? This is 9 points.
Right.
Block size is nothing but by storing the data in our Hadoop platform, by default 128 MB will be split and stored. 1 GB file will not be directly stored here. It will be split based on 128 MB and create as a, each one of them as a blocks. So based on the block size only, it will be stored inside. So this is a block. This is also block. 8 blocks will be, I just mentioned here. So each one of them, almost 128 MB of sizes, will be stored here. In Hadoop, 2X and 3X is a 128, and 1X is 64 MB. Can we overwrite the value? If suppose I want to store the data with the 512 MB of block size, can we do that?
Should be.
We can override by a command also. While we are going to practice it, right? I will show you that also. Hadoop commands we are going to practice. Even replica also, we can modify. From 3X to 5X unit, you can modify that also. So such kind of changeability via manual override, you can achieve it. But by default, you want to mention it, how much it is. Hadoop 3X, another one concept is called Azure encoding is available. We will discuss that in some time. Okay. Hope this 10 points, everyone is clear, right?
Dinesh, would you be able to brief that resource manager and application master once again?
Resource manager just allocate the particular job, that's it. I am going to process 1 GB of data, example I'm saying. I want to know how much record it is available on xyz.txt file. This is my request. I'm going to pass it to name node. Name node can get this request and can be validate whether this file is available or not. File is available, then it will be find out where the file located. The particular directory is going to be monitored and find out the replication information and what kind of file type it is and where the block information, everything will be identified and sent to Yarn. This is a request I received. This is the place the data is available. That's it. It won't do anything. Once a request is received to the Yarn, Yarn can consider how much the particular resource is required to complete this task, something like. Based on that, it will be informed to resource manager. Resource manager is nothing but whatever the request it comes, it is going to be made as a one particular job. That's it. particular job number it will be create and it will be assigned. This job ID based multiple tasks will be split and each one of them is going to be processed. All the tasks will be complete on each node based on node manager responsibility, node manager giving some right flag to our resource manager. Then only resource manager can confirm this job has been completed. This indication will be sent back to Yarn. Yarn will be respond back to Nemo. Nemo will be informed to our client request. This is the pipeline manner is happening. Okay. Just a resource manager, just create the job and create monitor it. Example, node manager is like a team leader.
Mm-hmm.
Tasks are like our subordinates. Who are working as a senior data engineer and graduate GET and software engineer. They are not like this. They are doing all the tasks. And the node manager, team leader is going to monitor it. All the tasks completed, the particular project has completed, the particular phase is completed. This information will be indicated to our resource manager. Resource manager is actual manager. All the team leaders.
Resource manager will allocate a set of memory and the code and deliver with an ID.
Resource manager just to create a job. This is the request I received from Yarn, and this request I can use this much of memory. Such kind of information will be collected and create a job. That's it. Once it will be provided to the node manager based on the where the data is located, based on that node manager taking the responsibility. Okay, this data is stored in my node itself. I can work this two tasks. Something they will be split and do some analysis.
Okay. Thanks.
Yeah.
Thanks for taking it.
That's it. Any other question? Okay, fine. GCP means Google Cloud Platform, AWS, Azure, as well as GCP. Three is famous nowadays. Mostly data science relevant projects, GCP only will be taking care nowadays. If data engineering, Azure and AWS mainly focused. Okay. Okay, guys, today is fine. This is enough, everyone, I think. We can continue tomorrow and we can go forward. Okay, any other question?
Sure. Thanks.
Who are all is interested?
Dinesh, will you be sending to us for a reference?
This video will be uploaded into our channel. You can refer
to overall video.
Today and tomorrow video will be free. Next week onwards, it should be a paid session. Okay.
What are we going to cover for tomorrow, if you don't mind?
The same, wherever we left, right, from that, we just continue.
I believe we saw some Kafka streaming and all those images being shown as a part of WhatsApp promotion.
Kafka, that is a project related, right?
Okay.
If suppose any free workshop will be taking care of that, we are going to discuss it.
Okay.
Last time, Kafka video streaming we just achieved, so that we just shared with everyone. Okay.
Yep. Thank you.
Yeah. If no question, we can close it today. For all is interested, just ping me in private. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone. We'll connect tomorrow at the same time and we can go forward. Thank you, everyone. Any questions?
Thank you, Dinesh.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you all.